I wanted to first of all review. I have a habit. When I'm in a conference like this, I take notes like crazy. I put stars next to what I call the golden sentences. Then I go home at night or next morning. I lay out all the golden sentences and I put new stars next to them. And then I pull out the ones that go together. And so just in terms of yesterday, take a read. I won't read them to you. Just read those and see if any of those resonate with you. Now, I only want to comment on the very last one there. As one of the panel sessions was breaking up, I tapped somebody on the shoulder that I've gotten to know a little bit and who I think has a very bright mind. And I said to him, I want you to look at the people in this room, meaning you. I said, and tell me their deepest common need. And he thought for just a second, and then he said, the faculty wants to change the world. They just don't know how to deal with the constraints. I thought that was incredibly powerful. Because I think that applies to every person in the world. And everything we're trying to do in the church and in education. And in the next time that we have together, this little time, I'd like to address that. I'd like to see if we could create a miracle in here. Here's day two, and I'll talk through these a little bit. We must build something that we have never built before to go someplace we've never been before. I was blown away by that statement because that is the statement of life. That is why we're here on this planet. And we deny it, and we can't see it. Our common purpose is deeper conversion. The only way we can do number one is to do number two. So why come follow me for deeper conversion? Why do we do everything we do in the church? Every prayer is for safety. We should be praying for opportunities. What an incredible statement, because the natural man in me yearns for to be in my comfort zone. Be able to do the things I already know how to do. Not to be outside my comfort zone. And where are those opportunities? Come Follow Me was a miracle that just came together. And Lee described all the things that went on in the church office building. And described it. He was describing a complex adaptive system. Now we talk about that in biology and chemistry. A lot of you should be familiar with that phrase, that concept, in the physical sciences and so forth. We talk about an organizational behavior, self-organizing systems. I can spend 8 hours with senior executives making huge amounts of money because they're so bright, and I can teach that concept all day long, and they go like this, and at the end of the day, they do not know what I'm talking about. It's incomprehensible to them. Because everything's about centralized systems that are in control. Here's someone claiming the core miracle in the church has just occurred. It's a complex adaptive system. His enthusiasm drove the whole process. On the one hand, we're saying it's an emergent process. On the other, we're saying, here's Elder Scott. His enthusiasm drove the whole process. That says there's a crucial role for leadership in this emergent process. The second one was about Elder choked on that one that time. People just want to be around him. He was the missing piece. I'd like to particularly emphasize people want to be around him. We give off cues that tell a kid what we're expecting of them. David O. McKay said there's a radio station right here. It's broadcasting all the time. It's receiving all the time. And we know what other people are feeling and thinking. 90% of the communication is nonverbal. You're making judgments about me right now. So 10% of it up here, another 90% up here. Can I trust this guy? What's it going to be like in here for the next 2 hours? The vocal one stood by the quiet one, and you could feel the strength transferring from one to the other. This was the description of the two boys. the two autistic boys. And then Lee said, after he said that, "Come follow me is a miracle." Direct reference to that sentence. The one boy stood by the other, and the strength transferred from one to the other. Knowledge is co-created in conversation. I can't tell you how important I think that statement is. It's talking critically but not harmoniously, but harmoniously. The integration of two opposites that create energy. Climate we create in the classroom is as important as the climate in the bishop's office. It is a huge temptation for me to think of teaching as me to him, that individual and me, and to not see the climate or culture that's in that room. I remember listening to Steve Covey before he was Steve Covey. That is, nobody knew who he was. And he held up a picture. It was a picture of the integration of Little Rock High School. The kids were coming into the school. These people were lined up behind a rope. And there was one woman closest to the camera. She had an apron on, little girl at her side, and she's got her fist like this, and she's screaming at these kids that are coming in. And the little girl's crying, and Covey said, "Why is she crying?" People offered a number of hypotheses. And then he said, "She's crying because she feels the hatred in her mother, and she's fearful someday it'll be turned on her." I find that to be a stunning and important story that fits with all those other quotes up there. Who we are radiates. And the learning process is heavily influenced by the collective state of things, by the climate. 70% leave because they do not feel it. The language of the gospel is the language of feeling. The language in these institutions that we build tends to be the language of the head. Okay, now what I'd like to do is to have a different format than we've had so far. Instead of doing what we've done every time, I'm going to give you 5 exercises. So we'll do, so we won't have the talk, breakout questions. We'll just do some of these things as we go along. Okay, number one. Apostle Paul, the word excellence is used very sparingly in the scriptures. Most prominent use is chapter 12 of 1 Corinthians, last verse. "I will show you a more excellent way." He then shows it in the next chapter, chapter 13. What's in that chapter?
Charity.
The same chapter we get in Moroni 7, basically, right? The more excellent way is charity. It's the pure love of Christ. I think that's enormously important. There's a ritual in the church that I would like to condemn. The ritual occurs every 4 years. It's almost written out. It's so repeatable, and doesn't matter what part of the world you're in. Every fourth year, we teach New Testament. About the fourth or fifth weekend, the gospel doctrine teacher gets to Matthew 5 and 48. "Be therefore perfect, even as your heavenly Father is perfect." 5 hands go up, and then in succession, the people say, "Well, it doesn't really mean that. After all, you can't be perfect. You have to be resurrected to be perfect. If you trace it back through several languages, it means this." The teacher nods, and we go on. You ever been through that ritual?
4 years.
Now, I would like to suggest to you that that is enormously important because it denies the Book of Mormon. What is the central message of the Book of Mormon? Come on to Christ. That's not only the central message, you just went to the crowning doctrine. What's the crowning doctrine of the Book of Mormon? Last verse says, "I'll see you at the judgment bar, so long." Second and third to last verse says what? Let's read it. "Yea, come unto Christ, be perfected in him, and deny yourselves of all ungodliness." And ye shall deny yourself of all ungodliness and love God with all your might, mind, and strength, that his grace is sufficient for you, that by his grace you may be perfect in Christ. And if by the grace of God we are perfect in Christ, we can in no wise deny the power of God. And again, if we deny the power of God, and again, if we, by the grace of God, are perfect in Christ and deny not his power, then ye are sanctified in Christ. And by the grace of God, through the shedding of the blood of Christ, which is in the covenant of the Father unto the remission of your sins, that ye may become holy and without spot. And I would suggest that if we went through the Book of Mormon, we would find numerous connected scriptures that say, when is this we're supposed to be perfect? Yeah, not after we're dead, now. That's the crowning doctrine. That flies in the face of our four-year ritual. How many of you have been perfect? Can't even dream of raising our hands. Well, let's find out the right answer to that question. I'd like you to engage with me in this first exercise that I think is enormously important to us and what we want to accomplish today and at BYU. When have I experienced the pure love of Jesus Christ? Now, we asked this in the seminar that we just ran, and we got profound answers. One of your colleagues, oh, didn't think she was here, that's what I was going to tell her. Anyway, one of your colleagues spoke about being on a mission in South America, climbing a mountain, an emergency situation. One person running for help, and she therefore has two loads, and she's got them tied to her head and her shoulders, and can't move any further until she screams. And then she describes a miracle. She said, in the miracle, the yoke became light. And she described other feelings that occurred and how her life was never the same. And others gave other stunning examples. Would you think for a moment, when in my life have I experienced the pure love of Jesus Christ? Now let's go to the edge of chaos. Would you share with somebody for 2 minutes or less your experience and what you felt and how you were different afterwards, and then listen for 2 minutes to the other person and then ask this question: what do our two stories have in common? Would you take the next 5 minutes and do that, please? My vision changes when I'm filled with the pure love of Christ. What an interesting claim. In 1966, I can remember one of my first experiences being filled with that pure love in one of those dorms over there with a girl named Sharon Bartlett, a very feisty girl who refused to pray. But we worked with her week after week. And then one night we went in there to teach, and every word we said was with power. And we came to the end, we knelt down, and I said, Sharon, you pray. And she said, no, I can't pray. And I said, Sharon, it's time for you to pray. And I closed my eyes and bowed my head. And we just knelt there for a long time, seemed like years to me. And then all of a sudden I heard this word, Father. And then tears, and then words, and she spoke in rivers of fire. Stood up, it was so powerful that we broke the mission rule. The three of us hugged each other. And I said, Saturday, you need to be baptized. And she said, yeah, I do. Now, we came down out of the dorm, walked across this field right out here, My companion, who wasn't totally committed yet, was totally, neither one of us said a word. And then he finally broke the silence and said, "There are times when you can see into the celestial." I nodded my head and we walked the rest of the way home without talking. Question: did those two missionaries I just described have any lustful thoughts on that walk home? Any anger, bitterness? Any kind of negative feeling at all? Question: were we perfect? I would suggest to you we were perfected in Christ. And I think that's really important. And it has some implications for us. Brother Groberg conference report, you remember the Other Side of Heaven, most of you have seen that movie, his mission in Tonga. And he says, you know, it was awful. I couldn't learn language. The mosquitoes were killing me. I hated the food. There were people trying to kill me. I had enemies, right? And he goes on, all these bad things going on in his mission. Then the hurricane came, then the starvation came, and then he laid there, barely able to breathe, with the scriptures on his chest, and then he describes being filled with the pure love of Christ. And the first thing he says, God's love changed everything. The heat, the mud, the mosquitoes, the people, the language, the food, they were no longer challenges. Those who tried to harm me were no longer my enemies. Were they still there? Were they still trying to do the same things? But they were no longer my enemies. How can that be? Everyone was my brother, my sister. Being filled with the love of God was the most joyous of all things and worth every cost. The vision changed. When I'm filled with the pure love of Christ, reality is transformed. The enemies are still there. But they're not enemies anymore. It's hard to understand. Part two. When filled with God's love, we can do and see and understand things that we could not otherwise do, see, or understand. Filled with His love, we can endure pain, quell fear, forgive freely, avoid contention, renew strength, and bless and help others in ways surprising even to us. Now, what I want to call your attention to is the minute before it happens, I don't have those capacities. The minute after it happens, I have the capacities to do things that are impossible, to walk up a mountain loaded with weight I can't carry. When I'm filled with the pure love of Christ, I can do things that cannot be done otherwise. What does God's love do to the human brain? Question number one. Anybody? If you think about what we just talked about, what does the love of God do to the human brain? Hint. Think about Carrie Wasden.
Fills it with oxytocin.
That's right. That's exactly right. We now know that most of us have a positivity ratio. We have two positive thoughts and feelings to every one negative thought or feeling. If you raise the ratio to someplace between 3 and 5, so it's 4 to 1 or 5 to 1, there is a transformation in the brain, literally the transformation that he stimulated by having you hold hands with each other. The first thing is the oxytocin, and then each of the other chemicals he described. And what comes out of that is something called the broaden and build theory. That when you go into that state, the brain opens up, you begin to make associations. Does that sound familiar? That you don't normally make. You see possibilities that you normally can't see, and you learn more than you normally learn. And I know of no more powerful ratio changer than the pure love of Jesus Christ. It's the extreme case. What does God's love do to the collective intelligence? First of all, you have to think, what in the world is collective intelligence? What is it? Where's my Hawaiian anthropologist? What is a collective intelligence?
It's coming from the connections in people's minds.
And when I have those kids in my room doing this Polynesian process, we're constructing knowledge. We're co-creating knowledge. Learning is hugely dependent upon this space right here. We think it's this and this. This is huge. How does she feel about her? How does she feel about him? Why does the climate have to be as sacred as the bishop's office? Because it's not about this to this. The collective intelligence is hugely important. Her courage to speak up and answer a question for him to hear is as important as my making some statement up here about some facts. What does the collective intelligence do to the human brain? Can you catch the loop here? What does the love of God do to the brain? What does the love of God do to the collective intelligence? What does the collective intelligence do to the human brain? I would suggest to you that collective intelligence, constructive conversation, is a complex emergent system. And when that system emerges, the people who participate are enlarged. The human brain is further stimulated in a positive way. Three scriptures. Your eye be single to my glory, your whole body shall be filled with light, and there shall be no darkness in you, and that body which is filled with light comprehendeth all things. What does the light of Christ do to the pace of learning?
Accelerate.
And that's a key word. For intelligence cleaveth unto intelligence, wisdom receiveth wisdom, truth embraceth truth, virtue loveth virtue, light cleaveth unto light. I think that's an important verse. If you look at that picture up there, the first time I saw that picture was when I walked into the Washington, D.C. temple, and I could not move. I couldn't take my eyes off it. That woman over there tried to drag me to an endowment session. I didn't want to go, but I went. I put my clothes on afterwards and ran back out in the lobby and stood there and stared at that picture. I'm a Philistine when it comes to art. But that picture spoke to my soul. I draw all men unto me. I draw them unto me. Thy dominion shall be an everlasting dominion and without compulsory means. It shall flow unto thee forever and ever. And the Lord called his people Zion because they were one heart, one mind, and dwelt in righteousness, and there was no poor among them. What happens in a sacred space? You just told someone else about a sacred experience. Did your relationship change? We did that exercise in class, and this woman said, I said, how do you feel about those other three people? She said, they are awesome. She didn't know them 45 minutes before. Now they were awesome. How was she relating to them? This is an interesting concept. We have so much to learn from the Polynesians, those of us who come from the mainland, about what Zion is. As the church built up, Zion is built by the following celestial principles, not telestial principles. You and I have embedded in us telestial principles. It's called the honors of men and the things of the world. And the sociologists and the economists and the others have built disciplines because it's true that you and I live by the honors of men and things of the world all the time. It's programmed into us. Christ dwells with the converted people. Christ reigns as the King of Zion. People draw upon them the glory of Christ. The people become pure in heart. Each person labors for what? The laborer in Zion labors for, not for me, for Zion. There's a common purpose. They become of one heart and one mind. There are no poor among them. Where's David? I saw him. Poor David. You know, we had a breakfast. I put that slide up. He comes up to me afterwards. He says, I teach accounting. I'm an accountant. I love accounting. It's debits and credits. It's right and wrong answers. And besides that, I've never had a relationship like that except
with my dad.
Tell us about it.
It's the only place that I feel I can be completely honest is when I'm with my father and my mom and my siblings. It's the only place I feel that feeling.
That's an incredible statement. So important. At least he has that place. Now the question is, can David the accountant proactively create that someplace else? Because at least then, his belief was, it's debits and credits. It's this one individual. What are you talking about? This is accounting. We'll finish that story hopefully later. All right. We did a study of value-added public school teachers. They were evaluated in a way you and I never are. We get the little survey, did you like the class, did you learn something? No, those are valid. But these poor teachers get evaluated in a very different way. Every kid gets tested. The test gets compared from this year to last year. It's computed, and we say, you moved your kids 9 months and 9 months. That makes you average. You only moved them 8 months. You moved your kids 3 years, 27 months in 9 months. That was a miracle. That's accelerated learning. Now, we talked to the top 1% of those teachers. I asked every one of them, what is teaching like at its very best for you? Now, I'm going to show you some mysteries here. Pay attention. First answer. I send my class into amazing discussions. In them, I learn new things. Whoa. They get into a zone. I try to set my class on fire. It's based on excitement for me and contagious. It transforms their work into a puzzle they want to solve. They want to do it even if there's no grade. It's about internal motivation. Now, I'd suggest there's some transformations in that paradigm. What are they? The students understand the flow of where we're going. It's a guided conversation. The kids take ownership of it. They all take the right roles. The class moves seamlessly. At a certain point, the kids can function without me. It's then that they love school. Everything becomes fun and easy. I'm moving and they're fully engaged. No one's wasting time. There's wide excitement. It's self-sustaining. They're proud of what they're doing and it's important to me. The adrenaline is flowing. They realize they can get excited about learning. I'm unconsciously competent about it. You have to decide what to do in the moment. Answers happen on the fly. I ask questions of the right students, and they make good comments. The others piggyback on and give their opinions. They begin learning from each other. This kind of teaching requires self-confidence. You have to try new things. It comes from self-reflection. You cannot be a follower. So you, Miss or Mr. Top Teacher, what's teaching like for you at its best? Four answers. Any sentences up there resonate with you? Anything jump off that page to you? That you find curious? Yes, sir?
At that very last point, you said you cannot be a follower. Now, I know to be a leader and other things like that, they sell, you have to be the leader of everything, but at times, wouldn't you have to be a follower to learn and to be able to be in those shoes and really experience those persons?
Absolutely. Undoubtedly. Discipleship, yeah?